Today we are going to speak on a very serious problem, which is a national problem. To some extent, partly it is also international problem. This is what we call the challenge that we, India, face from the threat of illegal infiltration. It's a very serious problem. To this is also attached one more problem of refugees, for which the technical term in the academic world is called forced migration. Let me first explain these two terms. Now, refugees are those who, in India's context, we consider those who had to flee their country, crossed international border because they were persecuted, they were terrorized, they didn't have any sanctity of life, property, liberty, honor. So these are the refugees. So in this category, say I will explain at one point and then move on to the next. Say the largest segment of refugees have come and still coming from both wings of Pakistan. What was once West Pakistan, what was once East Pakistan. Now, after the liberation of Bangladesh 1971, that became Bangladesh, whereas West Pakistan is now Pakistan. So, just to explain the basic point, you know, at the time of partition, Pakistan about 23%, the western part, 23% Hindu Sikh population. Now it has come down to 1%, 1% Christians, 1% Hindus. So massive exodus, decline, conversion. And it's still once in a while, if you look newspapers, you go to the borders of India, you will find the Hindu refugees keep coming to India. They come on pilgrimage to India for medical treatment. But most of the time they flee because there's no safety there, especially they have problem regarding their women. So they come and they don't want to go back. Now, these things are not widely publicized, with a result that people in India don't know. Only those who are bothered, those who are either doing research or interested, they try to find out. Another problem is a very serious problem that we face in the eastern India. That is what was once East Pakistan or Bangladesh. Just look at these statistics. The time of partition, 1947, Hindus and Sikhs were 29% of the population. Now they are about less than 8%. What happened? So again, bulk of them have migrated to India, forced to leave, abandon their hearth and home. They face religious persecution, they face discrimination, their property is not safe, their women are not safe, their religious place is not safe, you know. But you see, now one important thing, in West Pakistan, mainly from Punjab, the population declined from 23% in 1947 to 1% Hindus, 1% Sikhs, you know. Bangladesh is still 29% to about 8%. So still some Hindus are there, isn't it? Now, in my book on Chittagong Hill Tracts, I have explained the process like this. In West Pakistan, Hindus, Sikhs were subjected to jhatka. At one go, they had to. They were finished off. In Bangladesh, Bengali speaking Muslims, it is, that is jhatka, this is halal. Slowly, slowly, the the Buddhists, the Hindus are being forced to leave their country. So they are the refugees, you know. And the latest amendment to the Citizenship Act last year, the Modi's government, one very important contribution was that all those who once lived in India, whose ancestors also lived in India, Hindus who are persecuted, they can come and get asylum citizenship here. It's a very important point, you know. Now, as against these infiltrators, illegal infiltrators are those, there's mainly Muslims from Bangladesh. Huge number, and various estimates have been made on that. Even 95, the then Home Minister Indra Jupta made a statement, he said about 1 crore illegal immigrants are there. So one doesn't know the number, but I'm surely some government secret report, the total number would be there. Everywhere you go, everywhere, in the remotest part of Northeast, Mizoram to Jaipur to Bombay, even Kerala, fishing hamlets in Odisha, and of course, full of them in Assam and West Bengal, Tripura, full of them. So they have been coming. They cannot be, and we must take a stand, no matter who says what, that we cannot give them refugee status. They are illegal infiltrators. Why? The demographic factor is very important. India was divided on the basis of religion. Those areas which had Muslim majority, they opted for Pakistan, isn't it? That's the demand started taking place when the first idea of Pakistan was given by Rahmat Ali, subsequently Muhammad E. Iqbal. All of them said the Muslim majority Indians, they need a special status. So that was the basis of Pakistan. Same thing happened in Bengal also. The eastern half of Bengal, Bengal as such had a Muslim majority, but eastern half, the Muslims had a majority. So that went to Pakistan. Similarly, earlier also, the Muslim League wanted Assam also to be included. Fortunately, India saved Assam till then. And these are mainly what you can call economic migrants, because they don't have economic opportunities as they find in India, so they come to India. And what happened, and just look at the mindset of ruling class, when they come, and they come with the active help of all the agencies, border security forces help them enter, of course, for a consideration, and local politicians give them immediate voting cards, ration card, and now also Aadhaar card, I have been told, they have been given. So it's a big lobby within the administration which are helping them. And I have been told by, talk to any conscientious customs official, police officer, BSF officer, they will say that every day this infiltration of Muslims goes on. In fact, the number of Muslims moving into India is much more than the Hindus actually, you know, because they know that they have a very secure, safe haven in India. They will be taken care of by the various governments, especially the kind of governments we had in Bengal, Assam, until very recent time. They're very, very pro illegal immigrants because they think they will get a solid support of vote, you know. And this is very unfortunate, most shocking, that many of the leaders in India after 1947 have been refugees, either from East and West. And sometimes I have seen they have been the biggest supporter of these people. But those whose ancestors, people who are responsible for throwing them out from West Pakistan, East Pakistan, now same people are refugees in India. They escaped the Muslim atrocities. They want safety in Hindu majority India, but now also they are helping those elements just because of political factor. So we must make a distinction, and this is a very serious problem. And a lot of study. One important study I want to mention here is the governor of Assam, very respected army officer, Lieutenant Sinha. He was the governor of Assam in the 90s, and 98, 20 years back, he gave a very well-researched report to the President of India, and there he showed how whole history of this illegal migration from East Bengal, East Pakistan, and how they have been systematically settled in India. So General Sinha's report was on Assam only, because the governor of Assam. But same problem in West Bengal also. There are several districts, often these are news items, where Muslim become a majority. And chances that and some districts bordering Bangladesh, the more than 35%, 40%, things like that. So people really are fearful that at this rate, time is not very far off when there will demand from Muslim separatists that they should merge with Bangladesh, or they separate a separate Islamic Bangistan kind of thing, you know, Islamic Bengal one more. So that shows, and why they succeed is because they have a very big lobby, the government, the legislature, the media, in the academia. So these subjects were never, you know, researched, never talked about. Once in a while, some political parties will talk about this. Once in a while, some agitation, border areas took place. Assam, there is a massive anti-foreign agitation, which led to the Assam Accord between the Assam government and the central government, the IMDT Act. But that act was very flawed, far from preventing the stopping the illegal migration of Bangladesh Muslims. It actually helped them. So that had been also scrapped at the orders of the Supreme Court of India a few years back. And now a very positive process has begun in Assam. We call the NRC, National Register of Citizenship. That is being revised, and some very eminent lawyers, academics are involved in with them, and they are trying to weed out. In the process, it is expected lakhs or crores of people who cannot prove that they are born in Assam, they are born of ethnic Assamese parents, they will be identified, they will be marked out, you know. So this is, now besides this, we have been receiving refugees from Tibet also, beginning with 1959, when Tibet was occupied by the Chinese, when His Holiness Dalai Lama fled to India, 59. And they have a big base in Dharamshala, and refugees are, Tibetan refugees are settled in various parts of India. And this is one very good thing which government did, you know, because Buddhist and Hindus have a very strong cultural religious bonding for centuries. And so, it was actually a fault because Pandit Nehru's government failed to realize the kind of danger China poses to Tibet. So actually, because of the fault of Nehru's government, we lost Tibet to the Chinese, you know. And in the process, the Chinese started, say, policy of blatant discrimination, and the Tibetan Buddhists suffered. Chinese have systematically, say, denying, depriving Buddhists of their religious and cultural rights, and they are settling down the Han Chinese, the mainland Chinese there. So again, because of same religious insecurity, political uncertainty, they have no future, the communist regime, dictatorial regime. So the Tibetans started moving out to India. 59 onwards, they still come. Even now, quietly, every year, few thousand Tibetan refugees move out, you know. Now, this is one area where India had done a very big, but Pakistan, Bangladesh is a very serious problem, which has been a big failure of the government. Why did you allow? If you agree to partition, and partition, one condition, I must say, the honesty of Muslim League leaders, right from 1940s, Muslim League leaders said, we are different people. Hindus are Muslims, different people belong to different nations. Some extent, some truth was there, some also, everything was not true, but basically, they say we are different people, so we can't live together. And so Muslim leaders, they wanted exchange of population. Hindus should migrate to India, Muslims should migrate to Pakistan. But our leaders, Gandhi, Nehru, all of them said, no, there's no difference. You are one nation, you are brothers and brothers like that, you know. So even if Pandit Nehru, Gandhiji allowed Hindus to be finished off, they did nothing. Government of India was talking about the right of Palestinians. It was fashionable once in a time, in the streets of Calcutta, Delhi, university, you support, stand out in some of the Vietnamese people. American imperialism, go to hell, long live Vietnam. They will talk about Palestine, but refugees from Pakistan, West East, they would not talk about Pakistan, Bangladesh. So that is a tragedy, you know, because of a political culture, because of a communal vote bank, and all kinds of factors which you call by the name of pseudo-secularism. So this refugee problem is a part of a problem, you know. Now, some of the refugee problems are created by our own leaders because of the short-sightedness, and sorry to say, they had not taken right lessons from history. As a nation, we Indians, we once upon a time, of course, we had a tradition of writing good history, right from the time of Kalhana's Raj Tarangini. But then Indians of late, especially post-independent generation, they have messed up with the history writing, with the result that they don't take the right lessons from history. Another problem, refugee problem, was created by the Chittagong Hill Tracts. I'll just explain this. This is a district, hilly districts, very green, rich in natural resources, which was in the northeast part of Bengal, undivided Bengal. When the partition talks begin that India has to be divided, that area is 97% Buddhist population, totally 97%. So they told our leaders repeatedly that we don't want to join Pakistan, because that part of Bengal, eastern Bengal, was to go to East Pakistan, but they said we would not join Pakistan because we are 97%, and they knew that what kind of future they await Muslim rule. Unlike, you know, Hindus who have no sense of history, they refuse to learn from history, they are prepared to pay a price, but Buddhists, they said we are not going to join Pakistan. They are very much keen to join India. And almost till 13th August, even everyone, Patel, Sardar Patel, Nehru, Mountbatten, they agreed, okay, Chittagong Hill Tracts will come with India, not join Pakistan. Suddenly, they gave it to Pakistan. Absurd, you know, you are dividing India on basis of religious demography. So how come Chittagong Hill Tracts with 97% Buddhist percentage will go to Pakistan? So again, our leadership, they blundered. No sense of history, no sense of geography. They neither knew geography, nor knew human psychology, nor knew history, you know. And so we paid a price. Interestingly, now in this process, when the Buddhists of Chittagong Hill Tracts, they want to join, remain with India, that proves one of the, propagandas done by the certain group of people in India, politicians, academics, that Buddhists and Hindus have been fighting. So, for decline of Buddhists, Hindus are responsible. This is such an absurd thing. If Hindus were so bad, if Hindus had treated Buddhists so badly, then why do Tibetan Buddhists come to India? Why Dalai Lama came to India? Why he didn't go to Pakistan? If the Muslims were so nice, they should have gone to Pakistan. West Pakistan, East Pakistan, why they chose Hindu India? Because they knew that Hindus are basically civilized people and they have tremendous respect for Buddhists also. That's why they wanted. Now, what happens? Now, many years back, I did a book on this. The very, you know, unfashionable subject in the academic world, that you should not talk about refugees, especially refugees from Pakistan, because that exposes what? That exposes the weakness that government of India is a very soft government. It has no foreign policy worth the name. Its leaders are useless and they don't care for people who have, you know, part of India. After, you see, Lahore, Dhaka, these are very, very important places in our national life. What is Lahore's contribution, you know? You know what is Dhaka contributed? You see, when you go to Andaman cell, you know, you'll see 90% of the prisoners were Bengali Hindus. 90%. Somebody told me probably 98% are Bengali Hindus. Now, out of this 98, when I first went, then a guide, Marathi guide said, "Sir, you are from Bengal." I said, "Yes, I speak Bengali." "Sir, these are all 90% are Bengalis, all Ghosh, Bose, Chakrabarti, Banerjee's like that, you know." Now, out of this, since I student of history, I knew more than half were from East Bengal. So people who contributed so much for India's independence, who had gone to Andaman jail, now they are unsafe. They are fighting for independence. So what happened when they got independence? They become refugees. They are being hunted out, thrown out from their own homes, you know. Same thing, okay. Again, coming back, Chittagong Hill Tracts. What happens? Ethnic cleansing started there, Buddhists. first lot of refugees came to Arunachal, which was called Nepha then. And then over the years, again same thing happened. The Muslims from the plain land, Samatal Bhumi they call it, they are brought and settled there. Then their Buddhist Viharas temples were desecrated, army camps were set up, and then these Buddhists they also took up arms. And then the regular skirmishes going on between the Chittagong, there these Chittagong people called the Chakmas or Jumas and the Bangladesh army. Now to cut a big story short, here also the Buddhist population has come down, it's less than 50% now. Same thing, 97% to less than 50%. And where did they come? Most of the refugees came to India first, Arunachal. Some of them came to Tripura also. I had visited the camps many years back when I was writing this book. Now they have gone back. But they are facing a very, very terrible situation there. And those who are studying this problem, they know that there is no solution. And the Buddhists of Chittagong are facing a very existential threat to a very, very survival there. Okay. So these are some of the important refugee points. Just one more thing, you know, here. The Tibetan refugees. Now I come to Kashmir Valley. Now Kashmir Valley, what happens? Our own people. Kashmir is very much the heart and soul of India. Kashmir Vaishnavism is part of our culture. Kalhana's Rastarangi is part of our culture, very much part of culture, isn't like that, you know. And some of the finest specimens of human beings, Kashmir Hindus, you know. Now what happens? 89 onwards, they were forced to leave, abandon. And 1991, the entire Kashmiri Hindu population was, they thrown out. So this is a very unique case. Kashmiri Hindus are refugees in their own land. You understand? Bangladeshi Hindus is Pakistan because Hindus, Muslim country can't leave, so migrate. You understand Hindus and Sikhs in Pakistan because Muslim country, they're kafirs, they cannot leave. But Kashmir, which is very much part of India, and what is the history? Islam came only 1300 years back. They came as religious preachers, didn't come also as conquerors. And then gradually, they usurped the royal power. They started conversion. And just go and see how many Hindu temples are there, survived there. Most of them had been destroyed, desecrated. And so Hindus have been living Kashmir over the centuries. But still, 1950s some Hindus were there, 60s Hindus were there. Srinagar, you know, had a very sizable, very vibrant, very creative lot of Kashmiri Hindus. But then Kashmiri Hindus were also thrown out. And our government did nothing. They're still refugees. They're still living in refugee camps. You go to Chandigarh, you go to Jammu, you go to Lajpat Nagar. They're scattered all over India. People who had, you know, Kashmir, how beautiful is this? Prosperous people, highly educated people, very cultured, sophisticated people, you know. Fruit orchards, things like that. Suddenly, one day's notice, you have to leave this. So either what to do, you abandon your property, pack up your things, belongings, pick up few handbags and just leave. Dead of night, your neighbor will come and say, okay. From mosque, they are blaring, Pandit, go back, Panditain ko chhod do, tum chhod ke chale jao. Like that, you know. These were coming out from the mosques, you know. And nothing was done, no one raised a finger. So, total migration of Hindus from Kashmir Valley. Now, only few hundred families are there, you know. So, you see, this is, and a debate has raised, even now, a few days back, they will say, no, no, Kashmiris are migrants, not refugees. Refugees are only those who cross international borders. But that's a technical term. For us, refugees are those who cannot live in their own home. Because of fear, because they face threat to their life, because no one is coming to help them. If some government comes and look, I'm stationing my armed forces, I'm giving security, no one can touch you. Nothing would have done. That means no one in Delhi moved a leaf about that, you know. So now this is, again, to understand Kashmir's problem, we have to look back to the events of 47, when Maharaja Hari Singh joined, when the Pakistanis raiders, which actually Pakistan army, attacked Kashmir Valley, you know, Jinnah was still the governor general. They'd almost come near Srinagar. Until last moment, Maharaja Hari Singh had refused to sign the instrument of accession. Probably he was toying with the idea either he will maintain an independent kingdom. Jinnah proposed him that he should join Pakistan. Of course, we wanted that he should join India. But he joined India a little late. He joined India only when the Pakistanis had said their tribal raiders, who is actually Pakistan army. But then only when the army almost came close to Baramula, few hours drive from Srinagar, then Maharaja Hari Singh was in a panic. He said, my God, they have almost come. They had destroyed the electricity generation set in Baramula. So Kashmir, suddenly Srinagar just went dark one night. Then Maharaja sent a SOS to Government of India, Delhi. So Mountbatten was still, this is also a funny thing. Mountbatten was the governor of India. India was got independence, but Mountbatten was the governor of India. So Mountbatten say, you can't do anything unless because Kashmir is not a part of India. And according to international law, you cannot send your army unless it's part of your country, you know. So then again, they send a message. Sardar Patel was still the home minister in charge of Kashmir and like that. He said, fine, you have to join government of India, I mean, India, integrate India, sign the instrument accession. And then Maharaja Hari Singh signed the instrument accession. And then once again, all this discussion was going on as Manekshaw, who later became the hero of the Bangladesh War. Manekshaw was a colonel, young officer attending the cabinet meeting, the debate. Nehru was saying all kinds of things. International politics, foreign policy, whether you should take up this matter to UNO. Then Sardar Patel cut him short. He said, Jawahar, fauj bhejna hi nahi bolo. Then Nehru said, ha ha, Kashmir ko bachana hai ki nahi, ha, bachana hai. Then Sardar Patel told Manekshaw, you've got the orders, you do it. So next day, the platoon 6 Punjab, something was stationed in Gurgaon. They are brought to Palam and the first sorties flew out, you know. So that is how Kashmir was. But from day beginning, you know, of the Kashmir thing, Nehru's government blundered about Article 370. They promoted Sheikh Abdullah. Then Sheikh Abdullah wanted one flag. He said, I am not going to be chief minister, I'll be a prime minister. I want a flag for Kashmir, isn't it? And he wanted to be Kashmir like a sultanate, which Shyama Prasad Mukherjee opposed, and Shyama Prasad Mukherjee paid the price for that, isn't he? You know the story. So this is the problem. So Indian leaders had totally compromised, blundered, bungled India's case. And even then, when India's army was moving on, almost they had thrown Pakistan, I read a book called, actually Brigadier who was commanding that division, Brigadier Sen. Sen writes in his book, Slender was a thread, that few more months would have thrown out the Pakistanis out, you know. Then suddenly Nehru took them out of the UNO. And then ceasefire came. Otherwise, Pakistanis, this POK problem would not have been created. So then Kashmir refugee problem, Hindu refugee problem is part of that, you know. So to understand the predicament, the problem, the tragedy which our Kashmiri brothers and sisters face, you have to understand these factors, you know. Okay. So, so there are various factors. About this Tibetan refugees, from Kashmir I went to Tibetan refugees. Now, Tibetan refugees, they are settled in various parts of India, Dharamshala, Bangalore, everywhere you find most of the hill stations. Some of them went to Kashmir also, Ladakh also, because Ladakh is also Buddhist country, culturally same. But Sheikh Abdullah's government didn't allow the Tibetan refugees to stay there. But Tibetan Muslim refugees were allowed to stay there, still there. You go to Srinagar, you see, Tibetan Muslims are there. They were not asked to go. Only Tibetan Buddhists were thrown out. Now, they are doing their job. They are consistent. Article 370, won't allow Shyama Prasad Mukherjee to come. But we, only one set of leaders in India have been compromising. So many of our problems, especially refugee problem, are creation of that, you know. Okay. Now, in this context, I will say, you know, that the problem is this. Now, Tibet is a small problem, fine. Tibet was never part of India. But Tibet is very important. Tibet could have been a buffer state if Tibet had remained a strong state, you know. But India failed to do that. So this is a severe price we are paying. But Pakistan, Bangladesh, this is our problem. Okay, India was partitioned. Accept that. Then why you allowed the Hindu Sikh population to finish off there? You say we don't believe in one nation, two nation theory. We are one. This is the line Congress took. Then why did you allow Pakistan to implement that? So Hindus of Pakistan, Sikhs of Pakistan had to pay a price. What happens in India? No exchange of population took place. Muslims continued to live here. And except few thousands migrated. But a number, many of them came back also. This government sent people. Those who had gone from UP, various places, that you come back, you get your property. This never happened. So Pakistan is a very serious, very, very serious situation. I think only 3 years back, Punjab, East Pakistan, you know, Punjabis have been our major recruit to the armed forces. First Sikh officer was commissioned in Pakistan Army 4 years back. First Sikh officer. But the Sikhs are major 20-30% of the recruit, you know. Similarly, when I was in Dhaka 20 years back, I met the last, till then, of course, now some Hindu, first and last Hindu commissioned officer in Pakistan Army, 1949, this General Datta, who became Major General Datta, B.C. Datta, I had met him in Dhaka House also. He was the first and last Hindu commissioned officer in Pakistan Army, only one man. So he stayed till the end there. He then 71 war, he changed sides. He joined, came over to the Bangladesh Mukti Bahini side. He fought bravely, and then he should have been the army chief of Bangladesh. But since he was a Hindu, he could not become army chief. Anyway, so the problem is serious, you know, that we have to do something about the illegal migrants, huge number, crores. Assam, the government, they are doing something, isn't it? This at the Supreme Court has set up a committee, and some very eminent people are doing their job, you know. Hopefully, they will complete this NRC job, National Register of Citizenship. And there will be a huge human cry. Few days back, you know, one Muslim leader from Assam, the army chief, made a comment. So he again took up the matter of the President of India. But this is a very serious problem. But Bengal, nothing like this happening. But people know, even Calcutta also, Muslim population has increased. It was about 11% in 1947. It is about more than 20%. In Bengal, the Muslim population of West Bengal, 19%. Now it's 27%. So you see, this entire policy of West Bengal, Mamata Banerjee's government, you know, is this, to appease every demand, every absurd demand being put up by the Muslims, you know, because the population has grown. So once again, it seems very unfortunate, very dangerous. Then certain parts of India, demographic balance is changing very, very rapidly. And we have a real fear that these areas will one day demand separation from India. So, you know, to cut a big story short, what do we do now? That's a problem. Basically, issues are known, but these things are not widely known. In the sense, these are not often discussed in television channels or also newspapers, you know. Very handful of people are doing this job. But Assam people have risen to this occasion. They are very serious. And you see, look at the implication, the motivation of people who do it. Why you do it? You see, whenever something goes wrong, some people don't like, they said, this is a end of constitutional government in India. Democracy is not working in India. So much intolerance. But what is happening? You are deliberately getting people. You are inviting people. Bhai, humare paas aao yahan. Hum tumhe sab kuch denge. Ration card denge, aadhar card denge, passport de denge, jameen denge. Tum hume bhot diya karo. Aur jo marji karo. Bomb maro, jaan se maro, jihadi karo, kuch nahi hota hai. So this message has gone out from our people, na? They are our leaders. So dangerous thing, there's a lobby, very powerful, well-oiled machinery which is working for this. And as against this, what have we done about the our own people from Kashmir Valley? What is our the result of our efforts? And it's such a shame, you know, if you can't protect the ordinary normal rights of our own people, how can we be leaders of world? People say India will become one of the biggest powers. I wish we become a big power. But first, we must protect our own people, isn't it? And you see, you talk to a Kashmiri Hindu, how miserable they feel. And why they are reduced in this position? Because they became a small minority. And small minority, they don't have the importance of a vote bank. So no one cares for them. And since Kashmir's Hindus are intellectually very advanced, they are creative people, so they would not die of starvation. I think many of them are settled down, doing very well. But then why they should leave their land? It's a beautiful country and is a home, you know. So what happens, you know, that we are not very serious about these things. We must take it more seriously, try to find a solution. For that, it is very essential that our intellectuals, our academia, our media, and people in power, they should be more serious, think of a future, what is going to happen to India 20 years, 30 years since, as Ram Swarupji used to say, na, shrinking and shrunken India, shrinking and shrunken India. साइज छोटा हो रहा है, जगह घट रही है और लोग हमारे पास आ रहे हैं. जो हमारे साथ हमेशा रहना चाहिए था, उनको हम रख नहीं पाए, चाहे सियालकोट का हो या राजशाही का हो, सिलेट का हो, उनको छोड़ना पड़ा. हमारे साथ रहना चाहते थे लेकिन हमारी कमजोरी थी, हमारे नेता लोगों का बुद्धि भ्रष्ट हो गया था, कुछ कर नहीं पाए, उनको मरने के लिए छोड़ दिया. और इधर वियतनाम के लिए बोलते हैं, साउथ अफ्रीका के लिए बोलते हैं, सारा दुनिया की बात करते हैं. अभी बोल रहे हैं पाकिस्तान को हमें रोग नेशन डिक्लेयर करना चाहिए ना, ऑफन डिस्कशन पाकिस्तान शुड बी डिक्लेयर रोग स्टेट, टेररिस्ट स्टेट. इसी मैं आई से दैट 1947 एंड तक 48 व्हेन दे सॉ कि माय गॉड सच मैसिव क्लींजिंग इज गोइंग ऑन इन वेस्ट पाकिस्तान, आपको उसी समय पाकिस्तान से आपको यू शुड कट ऑफ डिप्लोमेटिक रिलेशंस पाकिस्तान. आप क्या कर रहे हैं, कैसे कर रहे हैं आप? 23% से आप 1% आ गया. जस्ट थिंक ऑफ इट, कितनी बड़ी मशीनरी, कितनी पावरफुल मशीनरी रही होगी. और हमारे टेक्स्ट बुक में क्या, हमारे टेक्स्ट बुक में आजकल चलता है जिन्ना को दिखा रहे हैं, गांधी ऐसा एक आदमी था, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बोल रहे हैं. जिन्ना तो पार्टीशन चाहते नहीं थे, हमारे टेक्स्ट बुक पढ़ाया जा रहा है. जिन्ना ने पार्टीशन चाहा ही नहीं, फिर पाकिस्तान हो गया. कैसे हो गया? उन्हें कैसे नहीं चाहते, वो तो एक काउंटर, एक बार्गेनिंग काउंटर था, ऐसा ही वो थोड़ा डर दिखा रहे थे कुछ मिल जाए. तो जिन्ना को बढ़ाने का कोशिश कर रहा. और हमारे एक टेक्स्ट बुक राइटर हैं, वो क्लास 12 के हिस्ट्री में लिखी है, एनसीईआरटी के, उसने किताब लिखी है मेकर्स ऑफ मॉडर्न इंडिया. उसमें सर सैयद अहमद और जिन्ना को बोलते हैं मेकर्स ऑफ मॉडर्न इंडिया, जिन्ना को बोलते हैं मेकर्स ऑफ मॉडर्न इंडिया. और उसकी आर्टिकल चलती है क्लास 12 की किताब में, हिस्ट्री किताब में. तो अगर ऐसा आप हिस्ट्री पढ़ाएंगे तो आप ऐसा ही होगा समाज ना. खैर, तो ये तो बहुत बड़ी समस्या है. अभी इतनी छोटी लेक्चर में ये सब ऑल दिस इश्यूज कैन नॉट बी से डिस्कस्ड ऑन डिटेल. वी कांट फाइंड सॉल्यूशन लाइक दिस, बट एवरीथिंग यू नो कैन बी सॉल्वड, सॉर्टेड आउट इफ यू आर लिटिल मोर सीरियस. वी डोंट वांट टू टॉक अबाउट थिंग्स. बांग्लादेश में भयंकर, बांग्लादेश मानिए, बांग्लादेश बेटर देन पाकिस्तान. वो बोला ना 1% हो गया वहाँ पे, यहाँ 8%. वो झटका और हलाल का अंतर है, लेकिन यहाँ धीरे धीरे हो रहा है, हो रहा है. हर रोज यू गो टू वेस्ट बंगाल बॉर्डर, बांग्लादेश बॉर्डर, हिंदूज कीप कमिंग. स्पेशली उनका डर होता है कि ना आजकल जो नया ट्रेंड चला कि हिंदू को जान से मत मारो, इज्जत से मारो. तो लड़कियों को कुछ कर लो, जवान लड़की होगी उसको उठा लो, रेप कर लो, फिर घर में तहलका मच जाएगा, डर जाएंगे, सो दे विल लीव. ये चल रहा है आजकल. तो बांग्लादेश में आजकल ही होता है. वहाँ कुछ लोग हैं बोलते हैं लेकिन बहुत कम, क्योंकि उनका जो, मैं जब ढाका में गया था, मुझे जो फीडबैक, द फीडबैक आई गॉट कि आप लोग कुछ नहीं बोलते हैं, अगर आप लोग बोलेंगे तभी सुनवाई होगी. तो उसके लिए कलकत्ता में पश्चिम बंगाल में बोलेंगे ना, आप देखें बंगाल में लीडर कैसे हैं, एक जनरेशन बंगाल में कैसे लीडर थे, अभी कैसे कैसे लीडर, आप कॉन्ट्रास्ट कीजिए। जो समाज का भयंकर पतन होता है, औरविंदो से शुरू, राममोहन से शुरू कर गए, स्वामी विवेकानंद, टैगोर, सुभाष चंद्र बोस, रिवोल्यूशनरी, इतने इतने बड़े लोग, श्यामा प्रसाद मुखर्जी, अभी कोई, सारा उल्टा, सबको वोट चाहिए, सत्ता में चाहिए, कुछ पैसा बनाना है, ऐसा जो हमारा पॉलिटिकल क्लास बन गया, इसी के लिए सारा समस्या हो रहा है। और रिफ्यूजी प्रॉब्लम, इन्फ्लेशन प्रॉब्लम इज अ वेरी सीरियस प्रॉब्लम। जस्ट और दो मिनट मैं लूंगा। रोहिंगा इशू अभी जो कुछ महीनों से चल रहा है, इस पर काफ़ी डिबेट हो रहा था टिबेट में, सॉरी पार्लियामेंट में, टेलीविजन में, पेपर्स में आए थे, तो हमने एक सेमिनार भी दिल्ली में किया, अभी पिछले गुवाहाटी में सेमिनार किया इसी पर, कि एक जो हमारे लीडर हैं, जैसे बंगाल के लीडर लोग हैं या और कुछ मुस्लिम जो सेपरेटिस्ट लीडर्स हैं और कुछ अपॉर्चुनिस्ट जो लीडर हैं जिसे सेकुलर बोलते हैं यहाँ पे, ये लोग चाहते हैं कि रोहिंग्यास को इंडिया में आना चाहिए, उनको सिटीजनशिप दिया जाए, रिफ्यूजी स्टेटस दिया जाए। हमने नहीं देना चाहते बिल्कुल। सरकार का अभी तक स्टैंड है कि वी आर नॉट गोइंग टू गिव सिटीजनशिप, रिफ्यूजी स्टेटस टू रोहिंग्यास, क्योंकि रोहिंग्यास के बारे, रोहिंग्यास कौन लोग हैं, ये बर्मीज नहीं है, दे आर ओरिजिनली फ्रॉम द रखाइन स्टेट, रखाइन अराकान नाम पहले नाम था, रखाइन बोलते हैं, इज अ डिस्ट्रिक्ट इन बर्मा जो अभी म्यांमार है, अर्लियर इट वॉज कॉल्ड बर्मा इन ब्रिटिश टाइम। सो देयर द मुस्लिम्स फ्रॉम दिस एरिया हु आर फ्रॉम ईस्ट बंगाल, मेनली चिटागोंग एरिया, सो देयर चटगांव मुस्लिम्स एक्चुअली वो सेटल देयर, एंड एज इट हैपन्स द नंबर वॉज ग्रोइंग वेरी फास्ट एंड दे बिकेम वेरी एसर्टिव ऑल्सो, सम ऑफ देम वेयर अगेन वर फॉर द ब्रिटिश ऑल्सो 1940s में, सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर में देवर अगेंस्ट द जैपनीज बुद्धिस्ट, जैपनीज बर्मीज बुद्धिस्ट, सो इनके खिलाफ किया था, एंड ऑल्सो जिन्ना वॉन्टेड दैट एरिया शुड ज्वाइन विथ पाकिस्तान, थिंग्स लाइक दैट, वो भी चल रहा था। देन सब्सिक्वेंटली वहाँ पे एक अराकान सेल्वेशन आर्मी विज ए मुस्लिम फंडल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, दे सेटअप देयर बेस देयर, और इनके साथ लोकल दे बर्मीज आर्मी का कुछ क्लैशेज, आर्म क्लैशेज हो गया, बट बर्मीज आर्मी शोड देयर ग्रिट एंड दे बिकेम, दे स्टार्टेड टेकिंग एक्शन अगेंस्ट देम, एंड समटाइम्स दे बिकेम वेरी रूथलेस, एंड दे सेड फाइन वी आर नॉट गोइंग टू टॉलरेट यू एनी मोर। जो इंडिया अगर ऐसा, जो टेररिस्ट साथ इंडिया अगर ऐसा बर्ताव करता तो वो चार दिन में ठीक होता था, अगर कश्मीर में गवर्नमेंट चार दिन करता ना, सारा खत्म हो जाता, जो भी शैतानी करते उनको उठा के चलो तुम जाओ पाकिस्तान, फिर देखते हैं क्या होता है। लेकिन ऐसा करने का हमारा कोई नेता हुआ नहीं, सरदार पटेल थोड़े दिन रहते शायद होता, पता नहीं क्या होता, खैर। तो रोहिंग्या के साथ अभी ऐसा है, गवर्नमेंट, सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट, वी आर वेरी थैंकफुल टू ऑनरेबल प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदी जी, द होम मिनिस्टर, कि दे हैव टेकन अ स्टैंड दैट वी आर नॉट गोइंग टू अलाउ रोहिंग्यास टू कम एंड सेटल इंडिया। उसके लिए बहुत लोग बोल रहे हैं, आप देखें पेपर में कितने कितने स्टेटमेंट दिया, और बोल रहा था भाई इतने सालों से पाकिस्तान से, बांग्लादेश से हिंदू आ रहे मारते, आप लोग कभी बोला नहीं, अचानक इनके लिए क्यों बोलते हैं, और जो नहीं बोलते वो भी बंगाल से, पंजाब से आते हैं, वही लोग हैं जो रेफ्यूजी बनकर आए, वो खुद ही नहीं बोलते हैं, अभी उनके नेता लोग बोलते हैं कि रोहिंग्यास को आप इंडिया में लाइए। तो इसके लिए एक मोटा मोटी कंसेंसस बन रहा है, अभी सुप्रीम कोर्ट में ये मामला गया हुआ है, शायद जजमेंट आने वाला है, गवर्नमेंट का स्टैंड पक्का है, हमको अलाउ कर नहीं देंगे। लेकिन वो रोहिंग्या अभी कश्मीर पहुंच गए, जम्मू में है, कलकत्ता के पास है, मतलब लोकल हैदराबाद में है पहले से, इसका मतलब होता है क्या, इज अ लॉबी अगेन सेम थिंग, इज अ प्रो रोहिंग्या लॉबी, प्रो मुस्लिम लॉबी, हु आर एनकरेजिंग रोहिंग्यास टू कम एंड सेटल इन वेरियस पार्ट्स ऑफ इलीगली। तो अबाउट 14,000 ऑफ देम हैव बीन गिवन लीगल स्टेटस, अनदर एस्टिमेट अबाउट 40,000 मोर आर प्रॉब्ली दे आर विदाउट एनी स्टेटस एज सच। तो दिस इज अगेन ए सीरियस प्रॉब्लम, बिकॉज वेर एवर द रोहिंग्यास ग्रो सेम थिंग विल हैपन, 10 years टाइम द पॉपुलेशन विल मल्टीप्लाई, दे विल गेट सिटीजनशिप हियर एंड दे विल स्टार्ट गेटिंग प्रॉब्लम्स, एंड every political party will use them as a vote bank, so we should not allow that to happen, you know. Anyway, so this is a very very big story, I have just given a very very brief summary, because this is a serious national problem, and we can only hope and pray that our political class, our intelligentsia will ponder over it and try to find a solution to this very very serious problem which threatens the very survival of a nation. Thank you very much.